Yep, should be start running right now. Thanks all for joining. Thanks for taking the time to and spending your evening with us for the Power BI Days meetup, actually evening meetup. We're very happy to have two presenters today. First of all, we have Ron, who's going to be our first time presenter for this evening. We're really happy that he's taking the chance to share his knowledge with us. This is directly a call to action to you, actually. So if you want to present at our meetup, please reach out to either Nikki or me. We are very happy to host you. After Ron has done his presentation, we will give the floor to Alex for his presentation. I'm pretty confident that Ron is going to do his own introduction. So with this, I want to give him the chance to introduce himself and take the stage.
Yes, thank you, Mark. Let me start with sharing my screen. Screen one. So let's begin. Welcome everyone to tonight's first session about building the ultimate data model in Power BI. Let me begin with a short introduction. My name is Ron Verhoeven. I have 11 years of experience in the business intelligence area. And my primary goal is to get people excited about data and analytics. Once that's done, my job is complete. The train inside the organization will just keep on running then. For tonight, we will have, I think, about 5 minutes for this PowerPoint. And the rest of the time is all demo time, so don't worry. So to start with, why do we actually need the perfect data model in Power BI? Well, nowadays, making beautiful reports in Power BI is easy. You click, drag, drop, show your team, and you're done. But building a decent data model is key, however. It's the same with this beautiful looking car. You can compare this with a good looking Power BI report. Everybody wants to use this, right? Everybody wants to take a drive. Well, consider the engine from the car as the data model being built in Power BI. Well, and if the engine looks like this, then you will be very sad and disappointed about your car. The car will stop working and your beautiful looking report will be useless. So, for this session, our report in Power BI is the good-looking car. The data model is our engine. We will show some tips and tricks to build a data model that will be future-proof and extensible. The primary focus will be on Power BI Desktop for pro users. And the Power BI dataset will be built upon a dimensional model. Dimensional modeling is the preferred data modeling technique for Power BI to build a good data model. We will not go in depth about dimensional modeling during this session. However, we need to explain the basics of a dimensional model for this session. Well, they consist of two table types, primary, fact tables and dimensions. For this session, we will look at the company called Happy Cars, a car selling company, and the dimensional model or star schema is being presented here. The basics of this model are straightforward. Our facts, the facts, the things we want to measure, the KPIs are in the center of the model. For example, the sales amount or the margin. Of course, we want to describe these facts. We want to see the sales amount, for example, by customer, car, or the year. The descriptive meaning of these attributes are inside our dimensions. So without further ado, it's demo time now. Let's take a look at our good-looking report first before diving into the data model. So I'm now logged in at my demo environment at the Happy Cars company. And as you can see here, we have a general first best practice, and that is that we split up our data sets in a separate workspace from our reports. Our admin will just love this because he will have all the data at one place so he can see what is being refreshed and what is happening in our environment. So the data sets in a separate environment, and you can see here that the reports are in another workspace. For now, we're going to start and open up the Happy Cars sales report. to show the things we're looking at at our company. Well, I know for a fact that my CEO always wants to look at the sales by car type, which types are selling good, and where do we need to put focus on? Well, for example, we can look at estates, the sedans, maybe even the minivans. But of course, let's look at the car type, the SUV, a popular type nowadays. And of course, when you dive into that, you can see one brand is popping out, and that's the Dieselgate car type. I just knew those cars were not economical, but hey, we still sell them quite a lot. So my CEO also wants to see the margins by brand, and then he's good to go. Then he has all the information he needs. So let's take a look at our Volvo brand. And we just look on our tooltip and we can see all the margins by type. So my CEO is done now. For our sales department, however, we can also look into more specifics, like the sales by customer. And did we meet our individual targets? So let's take a look at our sales by customer here. And when we look at our first customer, we can see that our target margin has been met. So for this sale, we did a good job. Of course, our sales department also wants to see some trends and jump into each individual sale. So when we look at the first quarter in 2020, we can see that the sales amount is really high. So we want to have an explanation for that. So we just right click on this one and we're going to drill to the sales details report for this individual case. And now we see that we have all the individual sales in one place so that we can do some further investigation. To switch back, we also have a second report to do some further analysis on our margins and to see if our marketing campaigns are working. For example, we have our brand here, and of course I left it open. I didn't reset the default view, so let's reset this one. So now I see my default view. We have our brands here, and I know we have the Volvo brand. So let's take a look at this brand and see how the types are doing within the Volvo brand. As you can see, we were interested in the SUV before. As men, we always want a big car. And I'm for sure that we are the biggest group in buying SUVs from Volvo, of course. Our marketing campaign is entirely focused on men, so I'm pretty sure we're doing well. So let's take a look by gender. And of course, the things I'm seeing now is that, wow, females are buying more SUVs, or target margins are even higher for females than they are for men. So we have got it all wrong. We've seen how that we are spending our money the wrong way as a company. We need to reconsider our approach on the market and reinvent our campaign. We have seen a couple of things now. We've seen some interaction. We've seen some good things. We've seen this good-looking report that fits the needs for a CEO as well for our sales department for a more detailed view. But what makes this report outstanding? And that is the data model. So let's look at how we began building this and switch back to our sheet. The first demo here, we're going to look at the exploded data model in Power BI. So I started building at first, and at some stage I thought, well, my data model looks like a complete mess. And then I was thinking, well, what happened? What did I do? So I started with this data model, and after some while it got really slow and really big. Well, even though there was not much data in it, we have about, I think, 20,000 rows of data or sales count, but the data model is around 270 megabytes right now. So how can we investigate this? What can we do in this type of situation? So we are going to look inside an exploded data model for this first demo and see how we can look at some statistics to improve the model. We will show the new way of working, the external tool DAX Studio, and we also will show the old school approach with the VertiPack analyzer. So let's take a look at our exploded data model. We will open this one up in Power BI Desktop. And as you can see here, first let's check out what the sales count is. We have our calculations here, we have some counts. Let me see if I'm right. Our sales count, we put it up here. And it's like I said, there's only like 23,000 rows of data in it. So that's not much. So to make sure the data model is still that big as I thought it was, let us take a look at our Exploder model. And as you can see here, the data model is 270 megabytes big right now, the model I'm opening. So that's really a big size for just 23K of rows. So what can we do? We switch back and we're gonna open the external tools section. The external tools have gone GA this month in the September release from Power BI Desktop. And you need to have the new metadata format enabled of the data model, but it's a new default from September, so everyone has it by default now. So let's take a look and open DAXstudio from this point of view. You can download DAXstudio from sqlbi.com. It's a free tool to use, especially for performance tuning and writing your own DAX queries. But in this scenario, we're going to take a look at how we can improve the data size of our model. At a first glance, when you look, you see we have all those tables here and on our left side, like the dim cars, the dim customer. And you also see we have a lot of local day tables here, which are hidden, apparently. And from what I know, we don't have these tables inside Power BI, as you can see on the right side here. Yeah, we don't have all those hidden tables here. So that's the first clue for something that might be going on inside our model. I have a lot of hidden tables, which I don't see right here, but I do see them in DAXstudio. So to further investigate this, let's take a look at our DMVs that are available in DAXstudio. DMVs, they stand for Dynamic Management Views. And they give you more insight about the model, about the metadata structure from the model. So let's take a look, for example, at the Discover Storage Tables DMV and run it. And you will see now that we have run this query. And let's take a look and sort it out by the rows count. And as you can see now, we have a lot of local data tables here with a lot of rows in it. Of course, when you have a lot of rows, it doesn't say everything about the megabyte size. There can be a difference in that. So we have to take this one step further. And taking it one step further, it means that we can go to a default feature in DAXstudio underneath the advanced tab in the upper menu. We have something called View Metrics about the data. So when we click on View Metrics, we will see the statistics about the model that's being analyzed right now. And the great thing about this feature is that you can see the database size in a percentage here. So you can see that all these local data tables right now are like 10% of my model, each local data table. So that's over 90% right now. So now I know where the data size is coming from. How can we resolve it? That's the next question. To resolve it, we will switch back to Power BI Desktop. And let's take a look what's really going on inside of the data model, because we have this horrible data table here in Power BI. And the horrible data table is actually a table with 2 rows and 10 columns. You can see it here. One table with 10 columns, all date fields. And you can see here that each date starts at the year 7053 and ends at the year 9999. So the thing that will happen then by default in Power BI is that when you open this one up, for example, I drag in the date one here, and you make this a table, you will see that for each field, it has a separate value for each day between 7053 and 9999. That are a lot of rows that have been generated that we don't need. So how can we resolve this, that those date tables are not generated anymore, those hidden date tables? Well, we go then to File and then Options and Settings from our model to the options. And right here we can see we are looking in the current file at the bottom page here at data load, and here we can see we have a mark on the time intelligence auto date time feature, meaning that the Power BI will automatically create a hidden date table for each field in the model that has a date or a date time field. So let's turn this feature off. Also, to continue on the topics we are seeing here, when you have some heavier queries on your database that take quite a while before they return some data, also turn this switch off, the background data switch. Because it will have to do the refresh a second time. So this also might increase your refresh performance when you turn this one off. So turn this one off. And the next thing we see here is the parallel loading of tables. When you're working with all the database types, you might also want to switch this setting off because what does this do? When you have like 10 tables, it will fire off 10 queries to the data source at once, instead of doing them one at a time. So we have an old database now, so let's do this one at a time so we don't get issues at other parts at the application. We switch these things off now. Of course, when you never want these auto date time tables to be created anymore, you can also switch them off at the global settings we have above here. So you can also switch them off at this place. Let's take a look. Click on OK now. So we switch these settings off, and let's take a look at our exploded model now. It's still 270 megabytes. And when we click on this one again and save it here in Power BI Desktop, we'll see a major improvement now. It's just 5 megabytes in size now. So just by these simple settings, the size on disk is much lower, and even the in-memory engine, analysis service engine, also is a lot less heavy than it was before. So this is a major improvement. Another thing we wanted to do was how we can get the same behavior from the Vertpack analyzer, the other tool we had. And not everybody has DAX Studio installed. Excel, however, will be available in most cases. To set this one up is less user-friendly, but you will get the idea. So let's take a look at the Vertpack analyzer. We will see the same local date tables here again, and the thing for setting up is that you will need a part number to connect to your local Power BI Desktop file from Excel. So the part number is already here inside DAX Studio. We see it here underneath our screen at the bottom. 59769 is our current port number. Let's change this one up, and I will speed this one up because it's not that interesting to see what the things I'm doing in Excel. We're going to the Power Pivot model to manage our data model. Then we will jump to our existing connections, edit them, build them, switch the port number we just saw, 59769, I thought it was. Yes, it was. Test our connection, it will give a warning. Yes, okay, save. Doing this a little bit fast, but we will get the ID now. Once I click on refresh in the Excel pivot table right now, we will see the new exploded data model settings appear. As you can see, now the dim customer is the biggest table, and we can look inside each and every attribute here. Another cool thing about the Vertpack analyzer is that you can easily extend them with your own DMVs, with your own dynamic management views. For example, to use Excel as a documenting tool for your Power BI desktop files. Yeah, we use it here to describe our columns from the data model. And also we use it to describe our calculations we have inside our model. So how can we export or generate this documentation from our Power BI model? We jump back to the Power BI model for that. We go to our model view. And inside the model view, we will have a brand table or something. Let me look. Dim cars, I was looking for dim customer. Let's look at dim customer at the birth date. For example, we have the synonyms here. We have the description field here. That's the field I was looking for. If we fill in this field, it will automatically generate the description in the Excel later on. So let's type something in Dutch here. And also, let's address where the field's coming from. So let's keep the data lineage in this field, which also might come in handy in later stages. So it's from the Happy Cars database, from the customer table, from the birth date field. So I change the description now for the dim customer birth date, save the data model again. And when you go back to the VertiPack analyzer and refresh your data, you will see that this birth date field is going to change. Or not, if you don't save it. Let me save it once again. Oh. Did I make this assumption in a different model? Okay. Let's do it once again. Let's save it up. And we're going to try it a second time, of course. I'm not going to try it a third time, then I will just jump it. Ah, luckily, it's coming over now. So now you see, we generated the documentation from the Power BI model, and it's, we have an auto-documented feature this way. So this was the VertiPack Analyzer and DAX Studio. We're gonna close this model off now, and we will switch back to another sheet. And we will go and move ahead to our second demo of the data model. In this next demo, we are going to see why the creation of meshes is so important. When we create meshes for all our calculations and KPIs, we can reuse them not only inside our Power BI data model, but also outside this data model. For example, in the live connection from Excel, or even from an external tool that calls a Tableau desktop report. Furthermore, by writing DAX calculations, we make sure that all our definitions are at one spot and we all work from a single version of the truth. So let's take a look at this next demo. Let's close this one off. And let's take a look at this one. And yes, here we are. The importance of meshes. The first practical tip, the thing I'm always noticing and seeing, is that in Power BI, each field has its own data type. It can be a number, text, or Excel, for example, a date column. And for all the numeric values, Power BI has the default behavior of summarizing them. But in the situation I'm explaining now, or demonstrating now, you can see that the year of birth, well, you don't want that field to be summarized. You wanted to show it like in a table at the right side, just as a plain value. So to change the default behavior Power BI will address, you can go to your data model settings, or to your data model on the right side, and you will see when you click on the year of birth that the summarization value is set by default on sum. So when you set this to don't summarize, and you will create the table once more, you will notice that by default the table will give you the correct values instead of summing up all the values. This will work fine in the case of when you work with tables. There is still a minor bug in this. So for some graphical table or for some graphics, like the bar charts or the line charts, this still doesn't work. Microsoft still needs to fix this. So beware, already said it, and wait for the fixes to also make this work on the entire product. Next up. Centralizing your calculations is an important thing to have all your definitions at one spot in your model. It's also a common best practice to hide the base columns that are used for a measure and also to prefix the measure columns that you want to be used as a measure. So let's create a measure to begin with. For example, we're going to create a really simple measure, something like test measure for the sales amount. And you already see I prefixed all my measures with an M, the M from measure. Of course, this will work in data warehouse scenarios. When you have self-service analytics scenarios, these rules don't apply. You don't necessarily have to prefix your measures then. But right now I'm working at some fixed dimensional model, so this is just fine. I prefixed everything, so I know by default now which fields I can use as a measure. I see the test measure inside my model now on the right side. I even made an error here. Let's call it test once more. And for now, you can see that on the upper right side, we have our own calculations table. So how can we create a calculation table in here? These are normal tables, and you can also create calculation tables. Well, it will happen by default if you have only calculation in your model and all other fields are hidden, but we don't have that all the time. So you can also create one, which is a really easy step to do. So let's take a look how we can create this calculation table now. We're going to enter some data for that in our top window, and we will call this table another calculation table. We will load this table up. And it's loading now against my data model. And we will switch the test measure we saw earlier, we just created. We will switch the home table from this. The home table we see in the left upper side here. We will switch it from the calculations table to the another calculation table. And the column one, which is, you need to have a column when you create a table, of course, we will hide that column. So right now, Power BI still thinks our another calculation table is a table. So the trick is now to save this data model, close the report, and once it's closed, you can reopen it again. And let me take a short sip. So that we can wait on our model. So now it has reopened. And as you can see, we have another calculation table now here. So this is the way to create your own calculation table with just by entering another data table and moving your measures around. The next practical tip I have, always mark your date table. Otherwise, you will get additional in-memory tables for each date field within the date table. Of course, this behavior can be completely undone by switching the report settings we saw earlier on the exploded data model, but it's a general best practice to mark one date table so that all your time intelligence calculations will work perfectly. To do that, we have one date table here, and we will stand on the date field here. And as you can see, we have something like table tools here up front, and there we have it, the mark as date table function. So set this one up and make sure your calculations will work perfectly and no more hidden date tables are generated. Next up is applying synonyms. The Q&A feature in Power BI. Well, a couple of years ago, I thought, wow, that's a really great marketing feature. But when you have looked good and more closely the last few months, you probably noticed that Q&A is getting powerful and powerful each day. The natural language possibilities will improve a lot when you apply synonyms inside your data model. So to show you this example, I asked Q&A to show me the result by car manufacturer. and the result is being translated into our sales margin, and the car manufacturer is being translated into our brand. So how does Q&A understand this? So let's take a look at our data model for that, and let's take a look at the brand. So as you can see here, we have two synonyms filled in, the brand, and the brand also is a car manufacturer. So by putting this in, Q&A understands that the car manufacturer is the same as a brand, in my case. Furthermore, when you go to the settings from the Q&A visual, you can also see which questions already have been asked by your business users, and you can further optimize and improve your model. So take a look at this Q&A setup. It's really fun to work with, and it's getting better each day. Of course, you can also do fun things with Q&A, fool around, trick your colleagues or something like that. For example, I can ask on the right screen here what the next session will be, and of course, when how late my session will be done. So let's take a look, next session. And here we will see the next session will be the tabular editor in an hour. Alex Powers is the one who's giving it. And based on my current speed, I will be done 5 minutes early. So you will have time for some drinks in between. So that's great. Let's move on. Next practical tip. Also in the world of data modeling, please look at your audience, even though it's a graphical feature or reproduction. Your CEO would want all these nice looking charts, but from an operation perspective, the flattened data set for analysis purposes would be more appropriate. Even when you want to switch to another data visualization tool like Tableau, you can reuse your Power BI data model. There is an external tool for this, which I already mentioned. Since I'm a Power BI guy, let's look at the live capability to connect the data to the data model from Excel. So we have an external tool for that here, and it's called the Analyze in Excel tool. This is actually the same feature which you can also use and address from the Power BI service, only now from inside Power BI Desktop. So let's analyze this data set in Excel. Also yesterday, Microsoft announced that there are a lot of performance improvements from analyzing data in Excel to a Power BI Desktop model. So that's big news. Yeah? Underneath the hood, the engine got really tuned. So please test this one out again if you've already looked at this before. Let's make this report bigger. And you can see now that on the right side, we have made some calculations. If we didn't have create any calculations inside the model, then we also couldn't be using these pivot tables or other tools. So calculations are also needed to make sure we can reuse our engine at multiple in multiple tools. For now, we're going to make a sample report. Let's look at our turnover, the sales amount. I'm doing this fast because we're not giving an Excel show right now. Brand, we're going to look by type. Of course, by year, we want to gray out the grid lines. We want to pick another design, something like this. We want to have a slicer in it, and the slicer should be something with the, well, what am I actually looking at? For example, the model might be good. Give this one a look. And the fun thing about this is that when you save this report, and you will do the same thing from the Power BI service, so not from the external tool. So if you do this from the Power BI service, save the report, you will get a live connection to your Power BI data model. So it's like a cube, which we know, of course, from our legacy environments. You have an automatically refreshed report, which a lot of business users are fond of for analyzing this one in Excel. So we created this one now from Excel. Of course, you can also create this same report in your own company style. So to make to have one fluent graphical style in each and every report. Of course, this is our happy car style. The company logo is great. My own daughter chose it. So. We also had a lot of fun creating this session. Let's close this one off and go to our next and last practical tip in the importance of measures. And that one is the one for creating your own measure table. A lot of times you will get a reporting question that your colleague wants to see, for example, the sales amount on a separate page, but also the sales margin and the sales count. But they're actually asking for the same page three times. So the thing you can do then is build three report pages, but you can also make one page and filter on a variable way to give you back the correct measure. We have an example for that on this page. As you can see, we can choose a measure, and this measure will be filtered out on this table here, on the table by brand. For like right now, we are seeing the sales amount. You can also look at the sales margin here, the sales count. Well, we have all those measures. How do we set this one up? We will need one, a measure table. A measure table consists just of the measures, just three separate rows. And then we will need a calculation to do the variable filtering, actually, of give back the variable result of the measure. Even though this looks like a great solution, it has one big flaw, and that is that once you want to give the measure also some formatting, for example, the one is in a currency and the other one is just in a plain numeric format, then it will create a text field from it, so you cannot sort the data field any good anymore inside a graph. So to address this issue, we will jump on to our next demo. Close this one off. And let's take a look at our next screen. Next demo is about practical DAX examples. Like I said, we want to show you the solution for our dynamic measure table. First, we're going to compare some different solutions in the DAX language. And after that, we're going to take a look at some time intelligence calculations and how we can make a business case with the calculation groups from it. So let's take a look. We have the practical DAX model here. First, to start with a no-brainer, please stop using the normal divide symbol in your calculations. See the below example here. Here we use the normal divide symbol, and here in the upper one, we use the divide function, the preferred action in DAX. Well, what's the difference? Performance-wise, the divide in also in a lot of cases will perform better, not in all circumstances. And there is also an issue when you look at records where the sales amount is zero. And when the sales amount is zero, when you don't use the divide function, you will get this ugly infinity error you will also see in Excel. So you don't want your business users to see that. So use the divide function, then it will show you an empty value, which looks a lot better in your reports. Next up, our calculate function. Calculate is a function we use a lot in Power BI. It's our context transitioning function. Right now, I'm going to show you an example with three different calculations, which all work fine, but all they can be addressed in a different situation when you want to look at the brand for each row. So we're going to look at the sales amount for the Bambergini brand. Bambergini is the great car we saw in the demo at first. And we will see that this brand has a sales amount of 826, and we also see the other brands here. The best way, performance-wise, is the upper calculation. This upper one is the best. Only when you want to see the brand for the sales amount Bambergini, you also want to look at brand again, it will duplicate here, it will duplicate each and every value. So then it's not the best choice, even though performance-wise in all other situations, it will work fine. So if you want to do that, go take a look at the second option. We will have the filter option. Well, the filter option will provide the row context to the Dimcars brand, to the Dimcars table at the brand field for Bambergini. And then you will see we get one separate field back for this one. Of course, there's also some syntax sugar or a way to write less code and to even make it perform a little bit better. And that's this one, the last one with the keep filters. It's actually somewhat the same, but it performs better, code is less. So I always use the third option if I also want to use the brand on the rows. So keep that in mind. Next up, we have something about ranking. Also for a lot of solutions, I also just look online to some features. I look a lot to the items or article from SQLBI.com, where we can see that there is also some brand ranking in our models. Right now I'm seeing my laptop is in sleeping mode, so let's click this one again, because I don't want to wait. It's really slow. I think my Wi-Fi tonight is actually perfect, so I cannot blame that one. So maybe if someone has a good joke, then please turn on your mic and let's take... forget about the joke. We can move on. The data model is, or the report is loaded. It's connected to our data set inside Power BI, and we can see we have some brand ranking here, which is a default function in Power BI. But we also you can make a variable ranking here in Power BI. This is a solution from SQLBI.com, in which you can make and address certain top brands. For example, you want to see how your top brands compare against your other brands. Right now, we selected the top brands parameter, and we have it set on two items. But when we make this on three, for example, we will see that we get three top brands now, and the three top brands are like 72% of my turnover. So why don't we invest even more in our top brands than in our other brands? Where are the possibilities from a company? So this is a fun way to look at your data. Also to see the DEX code behind this, well, this looks like quite a bunch, and yes, it is. Keep one thing in mind. Use variables for things you use more than once in one DEX query. And also, it's fun to copy the solution from SQLBI.com and put in your own flavor in it and see how it works. So really try those articles out. Next up, the thing we wanted to see, the time intelligence functions in Power BI. In Power BI, we have a lot of time intelligence calculations for almost each scenario. For example, we have a sales amount, but also we have the sales margin, but we also have the average sales price, the gross margin. We already have like five calculations, and in a data model, you always want to create time intelligence calculations. For example, the last year to date, the year to date, the running total, the year over year change. So that's already five base calculations times five time intelligence calculations. Then we already have 25 calculations in our model. Well, you can make sure that when you have bigger data models for bigger organizations, you will end up with hundreds of calculations. So maintaining that is really hard. Luckily, in the new release from Power BI, there is a great solution for that called calculation groups. So let me demonstrate that how they work, because I'm already fond of them for giving me a lot less work in building these all these calculations. So let's take a look. We have our time intelligence table here with a time calculation field and five meshes that work just by default, by only selecting the sales amount. So how can we build such a table that it can be reused across other meshes? So to do that, we will go and move on to an external tool. Of course, when I open the external tool from a report that is connected to a data set, if you open the tabular editor, it will give me a big error. Of course, the remote server turned unauthorized. I understand that because you can only use tabular editor on the data model. So we will switch to the data model for this one, and we open up Tabular Editor. Of course, we will get to know a lot about Tabular Editor in this next session, I only will show you a sneak peek about calculation groups. Once we open Tabular Editor, we have the table section here. And when we go to tables, we're going to go to create new, and we're going to create a calculation group here. When we create a calculation group, we can give this a name. For example, we call this time-based intelligence, something like that. Time-based intelligence group, a ridiculous name, but hey, I already have a time intelligence group, so I need to give it another name. And also here we have a field called name right now. And this name field is the name of the attribute inside our Power BI data model later on. So let's name this our time calculation. Now, how can we make those variable meshes? That's the key thing here. Let's make this a little bit bigger. First off, we're going to create our base measure. And the thing is, you have a default DAX function for that now nowadays. Selected measure. Selected measure is the key thing you copy paste in everywhere in each and every one of your functions, and you can just start working with this. So let's create a couple of calculation items here. First of all, we're going to create the base measure. Base one. Second, we will create the year-to-date, this time with the correct syntax, with the date year-to-date function, according to SQLBI.com, of course. Let's call this one the year-to-date. And also, let's create this one as the last year calculation. So we create the last year calculation here. Let's save the model. And once we save it, we will get a warning here that one or more calculation groups need to be manually refreshed. So let's refresh them. And now we see that we have a time-based intelligence group here, the one, the group we just created inside our model. And let's see if it works, of course. So we have a dim date here. We're going to look by year and by month. We're going to select a calculation, for example, the sales amount. And now we're going to put in time calculation on the fields, create a different table type from it, or a matrix, like this. And as you can see now, my calculations are already working. If you look at October, we have the base value for the sales market. The base turnover was 22 million. Last year, it was 70 million. And when you look in October 2018, you can see that the base value was 70 million. So my calculations, my time-based calculations are already working. When I put in another measure, for example, the sales margin, you can see that it's completely variable and it will work on each and every measure. So I think this is a great solution to further optimize our data models. And it's a big win on maintenance and our sustainability from our data models. So this was the last part of this example. Let's switch back to our next demo, and that is the one about the external tools, the ALM toolkit. As you know, external tools have just recently released into Power BI Desktop, but already we saw a large adoption group for these tools and their usage. We talked about DAX Studio, the Tabular Editor, and the Analyzer in Excel, all which hold great functionality. And now we're going to look at the ALM Toolkit. The ALM Toolkit, or Application Lifecycle Management Toolkit, is especially useful in a team with multiple Power BI developers to see the changes between different versions of the Power BI Desktop data model. So let's open it up and compare the exploded data model, which we started off with, to my current version of the data model and see all the changes that have been happening. So we will compare the Power BI template files for this. It's a genuine best practice to export your Power BI file as a template when you put it in some kind of source control, so the file doesn't hold any data besides even the size difference. So let's open up our ALM toolkit from Power BI. And right now I will need the template folder. The template folder is here. We have both templates configured here. And let's take a look at how they compare against one another. So we opened up the LM toolkit, select the first file. First off, the Explorer data model. Second, the HappyCause, the current data model. So let's do a quick comparison. And when we compare this, we can see in the left side, we see our Explorer data model, which we began with, and on the right side, our data model, which we are currently hosting. So when we investigate this further, we can see that this horrible data table we had in our first demo is missing in the target. So it's gone. Have we removed that? We didn't want that data table anymore. It was hideous. Also, a thing we can see is that in our new data model, the time intelligence, our calculation groups are present. So this way we can see all the things our developers have done, and also to let them know the things that have been changed, we can report the difference to them to make an export to Excel. And in the Excel file, we can just filter out all the changes and discuss it in our team. So let's look at our export from Excel, go to our data tab, filter out the data, and we're going to filter only the things that are different or missing. So this way we get all the changes inside our data model and can have a discussion in our team about this. A great tool, I think, when you're working with a multi-core development team. Okay, let's jump to our next demo. And that's the last demo for this data modeling session. Relationships are up next. My wife told me not to talk about this subject in public, but then again, I have to give a complete overview, right? So polyamorous relationships are just like marriage. Keep a single relationship with your wife and you're good to go. Moving both ways with different persons will backfire. It's the same in Power BI. You need to have a really good reason to let the relationships flow in different directions instead of one. So let's take a look at our model and how to maintain those relationships. Let's close this one off and open up our relationships tab. We can see our data model here. We actually have the same data model twice here. On the upper side, we have the data model that works from one side to another with a single relationship. And on the bottom side, we have the data model that works on both directions. As you can see here, the cross-filter direction is set to both. So why don't we want the cross-filter direction to set to both? There's a good reason for that. And there's also a good reason to implement it right now. And that reason is syncing your slices or cascaded filtering in Power BI. When you look at the brand here in our data model with a single relationship, when you filter on the diesel gate, you will see I get three customers. And also when I look at Toyota, you will see I still get three customers. So nothing is happening. So in this data model is technically right, but the cascaded filtering isn't working in this first situation. So what a lot of Power BI developers did then was turning the relationship, letting them work to both sides. And when you have a small data model, that might work. But when your data model gets bigger and gets more tables and more complex, you will notice that there is a really complex algorithm behind the scene that is deciding which relationship and which flow should be taken inside the data model. So in the end, you will end up with all kinds of discrepancies and invalid data inside your model. You won't be know or understanding what's happening. So only use a relationship that will work on both sides, for example, in many-to-many scenarios. I'm not going to explain about many-to-many right now because I will be running out of time. But in many-to-many scenarios, you can take a look at the SQLBI.com article about it. It's a great article, and just take a look to get more info about that. So when we take a look at Dieselgate, or for example, at a Toyota here in this second example, you can see that the cascaded filtering is working, but our data model has been corrupted. So how can we make a rightful solution or a correct solution for this? Let's look at our single data model on this side again. We can see we have the Dieselgate, or for example, the Toyota once more, and we can see that the customers are being filtered out correctly. So how does that work? We're going to look at filters, and you can see we put in a visual level filter here on the slicer. And yes, I know performance-wise, this will have a heavy burden on your slices, but it still outbeats the relationship setting both ways each and every time. So use this option. Then the last thing I wanted to show you is unrelated dimensions. Always try to relate your dimensions to a fact table, even when they are unrelated. Why is that? You don't want your business users to blow up your tables and produce inaccurate results. So let's take a look. We have our data model here, and we have a dimension table called budget model. Well, budget model doesn't have a relationship actually to fact sales, but in Power BI, we create a relationship for it so that our business users won't make wrong assumptions about the data. As you can see here, the budget model code is unknown. We put in an unknown value, and here we have all the normal budget model codes. So there is no relationship, but in a rightful data model, we will choose to create it. Why is that? We're going to look for that on the next page, and you will see that the unrelated attributes or the table where the attribute is related, we will get the right result. The budget model will just be empty. But when the attribute is not related, or the dimension is not related to our fact table, you will see that all the results are getting duplicated. So I put the business user at first, make him do the let him be in control. So relate every dimension to your fact tables. That was the thing I wanted to show you about relationships. In conclusion, we saw the usage of DAX Studio and the Vertebrak Analyzer to see what's happening inside our Exploder data model. Meshes are important to keep all definitions in one central place and to make the data model work for each audience in multiple tools, even outside Power BI. With the practical DAX examples, we showed the usage of calculation groups, which should reduce the calculation count on your model as well as the maintenance on the model. External tools provide us a lot of new ways to interact with our data model. There are even more external tools available than I showed during this session. For example, the Power BI documentation tool from Mark, or the cool possibilities you will find on powerbi.tips. Last thing we just showed, the relationships. Yeah, relationships can be complex in real life, but also in Power BI, only consider a relationship that works in both directions when you really have no other option. I want to give some special thanks to the Power BI Days Netherlands for organizing this session tonight and inviting me to speak, to Nikki and Mark. Also to Rafael Lukiwiki for presenting or lending me the HappyCars dataset a couple of years ago and some inspiration. And of course to Marco Russo for some great examples and explaining the DAX language. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for the next session given by Alex Powers about the tabular editor. Back to you, Nikki and Mark. I also think I'm out of time now.
Yeah, thanks, Ron. Well, we have 1 minute left to be exact, but we have a few minutes to do some Q&A.
Okay, very good. Yeah, if there are any questions, then Fire away.
I wrote down a few questions indeed, and we're already having a great discussion in the chat, so that's good.
The
first question is from Sharaf. He's asking, it's not clear for me how you made the documentation format in Excel.
How I created that one. I can show you that. Let me see, let me start this one up. And so also the documentation format in Excel, you meant, eh?
Also a more general question, if you're going to share the demo files, if that's possible.
Let me see, I think I can share some of the demos files, so that's I think no problem. Especially the further back analyzer, I can share that one, then you will have it. Let me take a look at this copied model. It has been a while back since I created it. How did we do that? You go to the Power Pivot window for that one, you go to manage, and the only thing I did was address or question a current DMV, a dynamics management view. You can see we have the Power Pivot window here, there where we have the third pack analyzer from, and there you can see that we have these two tables on the right side here, the TM schema tables and TM schema columns. I think I created them a while back. Let me see. This one, the schemas, these are the columns. Kijk, this one, yes, here we can see it. Here you can see that in the TM schema columns, you will get the description. And yeah, of course, it's the question, how can we get these values, or what's the query logic behind it? When you go to table properties in your Power Pivot window, you will see that I put in a select stair screen, a select query from my system TM schema columns view or DMV. So this is the way how we did that. And you can actually use each and every DMV that is available also from DAX Studio. So to extend your model yourself. Was that an answer to the question?
I think so. Yes, thank you. Very well explained. And another actually a remark about a few people. Peter and Rob mentioned, for example, when you were talking about the measure table, an easier trick is to minimize and then maximize the fields pane. Then you have no need to close the file. So that's actually a thing that you. You don't have to close the file and open it once again.
Okay. Is that a fact? Well, then you also teach me something new. you don't have to close it often.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay. That's great. So that's one step less for me next time.
That's for the next time in your presentation. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
true. Thanks. I thought you also had to close it to get it back. But if that's not the case, that's great. One step less. Thanks.
Yeah, I think it might have been the case before, but it also works this way.
Yeah, okay.
And another question from Sharaf. Can you change the Q&A language?
Q&A language? No, I think right now, Q&A was in English and Spanish, right? Or only English?
It's been in Spanish for several years, so.
Yeah. I think it was only in English and Spanish, so there's no Dutch. Yeah, I'm Dutch, so there's no Dutch or any language right now for Q&A.
Not true. Okay, and the last question for now, it's about the ranking example that you showed. What was the difference between the second and the third measure, so the filter and the keep filter?
Well, that's really, really a good question. The keep filter is just a shorter way to write a DAX query. And I also believe that when you use the keep filter function, less storage engine queries are being fired off. But I have to check that one out. I'm not completely sure. At least it performance-wise, they don't do a lot to quite another. Eh? They're close to one with the filter is close to the keep filters one in that scenario.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks for the. That's the questions for now.
Yeah.
So I'm seeing a lot of thanks in the chat. So
yes, you're welcome. Well it was done. A fast hour.
Yeah, it was. Lots of information, and well, you can all watch it back in the recordings later. We will make it available as soon as possible.
Thank you.
And we'll have a chat with Ron, what files and what part of his demo files he can share with you.
Yeah, I will look and we'll share a couple of these files for you so that other people can also use them. That's good.
Okay, thanks Ron, thanks again.
Yeah, you're welcome, thank you. And I also stay here for the next session from Alex, so if there are any questions, just fire them off at me in the chat.
Yeah, and let's start off right away because we're already a few minutes late. That's no problem, but we're just going to go right ahead with Alex. If you're ready, Alex, then I will shortly introduce you, and then you can start off.
Excellent. Well, you just tell me when, and I'll present my screen.
Yeah.
Awesome. So let me go ahead and.